Guys, welcome to this video. In this video, I'm going to walk you through some practice questions for the AWS Certified SysOps Administrator exam. These are from my set of practice questions for this exam that I released very recently, and they're very much in line with what we're seeing on the exam today. So let's get started. An application that uses an Elasticache Memcached cluster is receiving a large increase in traffic, and a SysOps Administrator needs to use a larger instance type with more memory. What does the administrator need to do to implement the change? Okay, so we've got a Memcached cluster, and we need to change the instance type so that we have one that has more memory. So what can we do here with Memcached? Now, this is one of those questions that's really about understanding the difference between Elasticache Redis and Elasticache Memcached. So let's look through the answers and bear that in mind as we do so. So do we modify the existing cache cluster using the modify cache cluster API? Now that's what we would do if this was Redis. For Memcached, we can't do that. So we can't modify. We actually need to create a new cache cluster, which takes us a little bit down here. We've got to create a new cache cluster with a new node type using the create cache cluster API. So as soon as I saw that one, I'm thinking, okay, that works with Redis. It doesn't work with Memcached. Maybe this one's correct. Let's check out the others. Specify a new cache node type with the modify cache parameter group API. Well, that sounds like the wrong API action. We're modifying parameter groups here. I'm not sure you can change a cache node type when you're using a parameter group API. Doesn't make sense to me. So even if you don't know these APIs, just read into the question, read into the answers, and make sure that it makes sense. In that case, it doesn't. And then the last one here, create replication group API and specify a new cache node type. Again, do you specify a cache node type when using a replication group API? I don't think so. So let's choose this one, create a new cache cluster with a new node type using the create cache cluster API. Now that's something which I believe you can do. So we'll check that one out, and that's correct. So let's keep on going. I'll just move this out of the way here. And let's go to the next question. So a SysOps administrator has deployed an infrastructure stack for a company using CloudFormation. The company made some manual changes to the infrastructure. The administrator needs to capture the changes and update the CloudFormation template. How can the administrator determine what changes were made? So this is one of those situations where we've deployed something through CloudFormation, but then some manual changes have been made. Whenever you're using CloudFormation, you want to try and avoid then going in and modifying stuff manually, because now suddenly your actual state is different to how it was deployed through CloudFormation. So what we need to do now is try and rectify that, because we want CloudFormation to be able to manage the updates to our stack, and we can't do that if it's out of sync. So let's have a look at different ways of doing this. Starting from the top, create a new CloudFormation stack based on the changes that were made, delete the old stack and deploy the new stack. Well, we don't really know what changes were made in this case. We've got to identify them first. So if we did that, if we'd identified them, we could do this, but we don't need to do this. There's another way. Next is update the CloudFormation stack using a change set. Review the changes and update the stack. Again, if we knew what the changes were, we could use a change set, but we don't know that at this stage. Next up, we've got update the CloudFormation stack by modifying the selected parameters in the template to match what was changed. Again, sort of coming back, this is, you know, a bit more logical than it is technical here. The question is asking us to determine what changes were made. If we don't know what changes were made, then, you know, we can't update the template. Lastly, use drift detection on the CloudFormation stack. Starting to make sense now. Drift detection is actually going to detect what's changed. It's going to go out and try and work out, okay, this is the template. So based on the template, this is how the infrastructure should look. How does it look today? And then it's going to find out the drift. So the drift is the difference between what it should be and what it actually is. And then use the output of drift detection to update the CloudFormation template and redeploy the stack. So that all makes sense. I like the fourth option here. Let's choose to that one and just check the answer. Looks good. Let's keep on going. We've got another question here. A company manage an application that is deployed on EC2 instances within a private subnet. The EC2 instances must be restricted from the internet for security and compliance, and the SysOps team must be able to manage the instances from the corporate office using SSH. which combination actions should be taken to permit SSH to the instances while meeting the security and compliance requirements. And it's another one where we've got to select two answers. So let's look through these. What about a NAT gateway? Well, adding a NAT gateway to the VPC and configure and routing, that's going to enable instances in private subnets to be able to access the internet, but that's not what we're trying to solve here. So that doesn't look good at all. Now, add a virtual private gateway to the VPC and configure routing. Now, that's part of the setup of a VPN. So if we wanted to set up a VPN from the office, that's what we would need. We would need a virtual private gateway. That's one side. That's the Amazon side. So potentially, if we're going down the road of creating a VPN, which I think makes sense, that's going to be one part of the answer. Next up, attach an internet gateway to the VPC and configure routing. Well, internet gateways are obviously for internet access. In this case, we actually want to connect a VPN. So I don't need that answer. Configure a VPN connection back to the corporate office. Well, that sounds good. That means you then create your customer gateway in your office environment, and that would then connect you to your virtual private gateway on AWS, and you've got a VPN. So I like those two. That looks like the best combination. Lastly, let's just check this one out. Configure a network load balancer in front of EC2. Well, that's not going to help us, is it? We're trying to connect to it privately. That's not going to help. We need a way of connecting privately to our instances. A network load balancer is just going to distribute connections, but you've got to get to it first. So I like these two. Let's check out this answer. That looks good. Let's just scroll down, and we've even got a diagram here showing us a typical configuration with a customer gateway in a corporate network, a virtual private gateway on the AWS side, and that connects you into your router and your VPC. So let's move on to the next question. A web application runs on several EC2 instances in an ASG across availability zones, all availability zones in a region. A SysOps administrator notices that the ASG does not launch new instances during busy periods. The maximum capacity of the ASG has not been reached. So what should the administrator do to identify the cause of the issue? So we've got multiple availability zones. We've got all of the availability zones that are available. That could be a minimum of two availability zones, and it could be more than that. And the ASG is not launching new instances, but the maximum capacity is not being reached. So that's interesting. So we've got the ASG configured so that it should be launching new instances during busy periods, but it's not. So why would that be? Well, let's try and work out the cause of the issue. How do we go about that? Do we use Trusted Advisor to check if service limits have been reached? Well, that makes sense. If you reach the limit for the number of EC2 instances that you're able to launch in a region, because this whole scenario is within a region, then you're not going to be able to launch them, even if your ASG is configured to, with a maximum capacity that should allow more instances. So I like that one. That's a good answer there. What about checking the personal health dashboard? Well, that's a way that you would check for outages or some kind of maintenance that might be affecting your resources. But I don't think that's what we want to look for here. Next up, we've got monitoring limits in Systems Manager. You don't monitor limits in Systems Manager, so I don't think that's correct. Do we use Inspector to view performance information? No, you're more likely to use CloudWatch metrics to view performance information. Inspector is going to give you some information, best practice guidance on how to configure your infrastructure. But CloudWatch would be for metrics related to performance. We've then got CloudTrail to check the result of the run instances requests. Well, imagine if for some reason the run instances, which is the API action that's attempting to launch the instances, is failing for some reason. It could be permissions, or it could be because of service limits. We would want to see that because, you know, something's trying to happen, but it's failing for some reason, and CloudTrail can be capturing that information. So I like those two options. Let's check out those answers. And that's correct. We've got those two correct. So let's move on to another question. A SysOps administrator has been asked to monitor the costs incurred by each user in an AWS account. How can the SysOps administrator collect that information? Again, this is a two-part question. We've got two answers here. So let's see how you might do that. How would you monitor costs on a user basis? Well, straight away, I've got the created by tag up here, and I like that because, you know, when you're launching a resource, you're creating it, and there's a created by tag that you can enable. You have to activate that in your account. Once you've done that, then it will record that information. So that's part of the answer. I like that. We've got the created by tag, we're recording that information, and then how can we now analyze who is doing, who is spending what money based on the information that's being recorded here? Well, if I scroll down just a couple, we've got analyzed usage with Cost Explorer, and that makes sense. Cost Explorer is a tool in the billing dashboard that you can use for breaking down your costs at an itemized level. So straight away, I like those two. Let's just check out the others. Do we create user metrics in CloudWatch? No, it's more for performance monitoring. What about using Inspector to advise on resource costs? Well, it does give you some best practice guidance in terms of how you can optimize costs in your AWS account, but Inspector is not going to give you that granularity in terms of identifying which users are spending the most money. What about creating a billing alarm in AWS budgets? You can do that. You can create billing alarms, but that's not going to help us here. We're not looking for an alarm, and we're not setting budgets either. We're just monitoring the costs. So I like these two answers. Let's check those out. Those are good answers, so let's go on to the next one. A SysOps administrator has started to use Amazon Inspector to assess Amazon EC2 instances for security and compliance. The administrator noticed that some security findings are missing for some instances. Which actions should the administrator take to attempt to resolve this issue? Inspector does come up quite a bit in the exam. We've seen it in a couple of questions here as well, so make sure you understand it. So we've got Amazon Inspector, and we want to assess our EC2 instances for security and compliance information, but some information is missing. So how would we go about finding out what is going on? How do we resolve this issue? Again, let's work down from the top. Do we generate the missing security findings list manually by logging into the affected EC2 instances and running CLI commands? Whenever you see something that's relating to manual work like this in an AWS exam, you can pretty much say that that's not going to be the answer. You know, very, very rarely is anything like that going to be the answer. AWS want you to automate everything. So manually logging into instances and having to do that kind of work is just, it's just not a scalable thing. And it's just not something they're going to recommend you do. Next up, we've got to verify that the unified agent for CloudWatch is installed on the instances. Well, the unified agent is where it collects CloudWatch metrics and also it collects CloudWatch logs information as well. But we don't need that for this. That's not related to the security and compliance information that's being gathered and used by Amazon Inspector. What about moving the instances to a public subnet and attaching an Elasticache IP? Well, that might make you think, well, Amazon Inspector, is it a public service? Do they need to have that public connectivity? Well, that is not the answer here. You do not need to move the instances to a public subnet, and they don't need an Elasticache IP. They can be in a private subnet, absolutely. Next up, we've got the one that looks the most obvious now because all the other ones definitely eliminated themselves. So lastly, we have verify that the Inspector agent is installed and running on the affected instances, and then restart the agent. Now, you don't absolutely need the agent, but to get most information or to get, you know, the full set of information, you do need the agent. So it's worth checking that it's on the instance. And if it is, then restart the agent. That might fix the problem. So I like that answer. We're going to stick with that one and move on. And sure enough, that's the correct answer. So let's go through to our last question. A company stores a large volume of non-critical log files in S3. An Amazon EC2 instance processes files from the bucket on a daily basis, and we're looking for what's the most cost-effective storage option for this particular scenario. Now, when I see non-critical log files, straight away I'm thinking, okay, so if it's non-critical, then how can we save a bit of money? Like, how can we get away from S3 standard and actually choose a cheaper storage class? But as I go through this list here, I'm thinking it doesn't make sense because infrequent accessed, that's not really the case because the files get processed on a daily basis. So you do have to pay retrieval fees, or you do have to pay some fees for actually reading those records. So infrequent access is probably not it. With Glacier, we wouldn't get immediate access. You've got to restore that archive. And then once you've got the archive back, you can then access the files, but that could take time. So that's not going to give you the access to process this information daily. So I don't like that either. We've then got the instance store. Well, the instance store is a type of volume that you attach to EC2 instances rather than Elastic Block Store, which is a disk that's kind of remote to the actual EC2 instance hardware, the hardware your EC2 instance runs on. Instance stores are local to that hardware. They're high performance, but they're ephemeral storage. That means data is lost when you shut down your instance. In fact, you can't even shut down an instance with an instance store volume if it's the root volume. So you can only restart them. But that data gets lost when you terminate the instance. There's no way you can keep it. So instance stores are nothing to do with this particular use case. So actually, S3 standard is fine. You know, it's still cheap storage and it makes sense for this particular scenario. So I like that answer. I'm going to click on check. And sure enough, we do have the right answer there. And here is the table from the AWS website with the information on the storage tiers. For all of the associate level exams and the cloud practitioner and the professional levels as well, you definitely need to know this. So just make sure you understand the different storage classes. This comes up all the time. That's it for this video. I hope it was useful to you, and I wish you the best for your exam.